So anyway, I really appreciate all of you coming to things like this and doing the work that you do. You know, of all the pregnancy centers and the pro-life work and the legislative work and things that you all are a part of, I personally am so grateful and wish that I would have known of such organizations as yours, or I would not be here telling you the story that I am today. So particularly Molly Smith and Bringing America Back to Life, all of you. And Tim Overland from Personhood, Iowa, is one of the directors for the Bring America Back to Life and the Personhood Alliance here. But he is really ripping it up at the state capitol in Iowa, and I value the work that you guys are doing. It's a certain calling that you guys have. So there is a lot that I wanted to share with you, but first of all, does anybody know what this is? It's a baobab tree, okay? So I visited Zambia, Africa, this fall, where Molly is from, and I brought back one for her, and it's similar to this, but a lot of people were like, what is this thing? Hers looked a little bit different. You can hang your jewelry on it and things like that. It's made out of banana tree leaves, which is funny, making banana tree leaves to make a baobab tree, but anyway, they're creative talents there. But the reason this tree is really important is because they actually look like this in Africa, where the roots look like they're growing up into the air, right? That's significant because these trees grow in the harshest of conditions, right? Kind of like you guys out there in the pro-life world. You're growing in the harshest of conditions. But during the rainy season, it's really interesting. It will store water and suck it all up into its vast trunk and swell. And it grows far above. I mean, it stands out in the African plains and the bush. There is phenomenal. But it's also known as the upside-down tree. Whoop, I'm back. Went a little far here, but it's also known as the upside down tree. But here's something else about this tree. It produces fruit with more antioxidants, and it's the healthiest fruit of all of the trees that there are. Isn't that interesting that a tree that grows in maybe 11 and a half months of dry weather in Africa produces the best fruit, but it's because of the nutrients and all the things that are going on under the surface that you don't see happening on the outside, yeah? This tree of life. It is also called the upside down tree, but here's something that I wanted to share with you from the Bible in the book of Acts chapter 5, verse 17. It says, but the unbelieving Jews became jealous, and taking along some thugs and lowlifes from the marketplace, they formed a mob and they set the city in an uproar. That would never happen in America, right? And then attacking Jason's house, they tried to bring Paul and Silas out to the people, but when they failed to find them, they dragged Jason and some brothers before the city authorities, shouting, these men who have turned the world upside down have come here too. And Jason has welcomed them into his house and protected them. This was scandalous. And they are all saying things contrary to the decrees of Caesar. In other words, what these guys are doing, it's turning the world upside down, and they're going against the written law of the land. Amen. That, right? And I love this. Actually claiming that there is another king, Jesus. Amen? Well, and that's what I love about all of you here. Now, this is an actual baobab in Africa. One tree. You all are like this. You are like those gathering, and you're upside down to the rest of the world. They can't figure you out, right? But we're here this weekend, gathered together in unity like this, around the tree of life, to turn the world right side up. Yeah? Yeah. Yeah, right. You know, and I can understand why some of these people are turning their cities into an uproar. These people are hurting. And I believe, having had an abortion myself, that these people who are so angry and livid that they don't know what to do with their emotions and they don't know how to justify the pain that they're in, right? You know, they say hurting people hurt people. And so I want to be one of those who approaches these people and says, rather than what's wrong with you, I want to say, what's wrong? You know, I just want to look them straight in the eye and say, tell me about your abortion. And come at it from a different angle, because they don't know the love of God that we do, I believe. Or they're in denial and covering up and justifying the things that they have been through. That's pretty easy to do. But we are here to declare there is another King, Jesus. He certainly has set me free indeed. Now, No One Could Know is my gritty memoir of love and abortion, guilt, religious cover-up. And my book is actually pretty funny, at least in the beginning. It's been really interesting to write such a book as I have about an abortion and about later being raped. You know, you expect it to reach the obvious, those who've been through it and the women who are against it or pro-life people. But what has surprised me is the number of men who have said, oh my gosh, Kristan, that's my story. I've had 4 military men contact me and say, I read your book, and oh my gosh, that ministered to my heart so much because they were raped in the military. Apparently, that's quite a big problem. You've probably heard some about that. And by day, I'm a reporter, and I interviewed a gentleman who had been given command of a Navy ship, and he called me from Japan. We did the interview, and then afterward, he said, so you've written a book. I thought, I don't remember saying anything like that, but he had Googled my name and had read all the reviews, had found my book and read all the reviews on Amazon. He said, I want that book in my ship library. And I also have had an Army gentleman contact me and say that he has read the book and he's working to get it in all of the base libraries as part of their resiliency program. And so, because I deal with a PTSD issue as well. So, you know, when you step out and obey God, you never know the things that he'll have you to do and the places he'll have you to go. But, oh, what a ride, yeah? So, my book, you can learn a lot more. If you have your bags, your conference bags, my flyer looks like this, and you can read more about it there. Or you can visit me out on my book table. And after the conference, after this hour, I will go to my book table and have a book signing for those of you who want it. It's $10 today only, special. And tomorrow it goes up to the regular price of $15, or you can get it at kristengray.com or all the other online Christian retailers. So yeah, my story kind of began when I was a teenager, and my boyfriend and I had been dating for quite a long time before the relationship got physical, and I don't even remember the first kiss. You know, how sad is that, that you don't even remember such a thing that should be so monolithic? You know, it's something that once you start that first kiss, it's a train that's pretty hard to stop. So now I tell all those who have never been kissed to wait until the pastor says, you may now kiss the bride, right? So that's kind of an important part of the progression of things. So one December day, we left school to go to lunch at my boyfriend's house. And things moved pretty quickly from there. We had no plans. These kinds of things just happen sometimes, and as it was in our case. So all of a sudden, poof, within minutes, the condom broke, and he said, oh my gosh, I know you're pregnant, And I'm like, wait a minute, what just happened? Was I even there? I don't even know what just happened. He's like, I know you're pregnant. I said, but it's my first time, it's our first time. How could I possibly be pregnant? What are you talking about? No. And he just said, yes, I know that you are pregnant, and no one can know. After all, what about our parents? What in the church? We were churchgoers. So I just said, look, I've got to go back to class. So he dropped me back at school. I just slipped right into my class. He went on to his classes, and school went on like nobody knew anything else was any different. And so I understood. I sat there in English understanding why they call it losing your virginity. I felt something definitely had been lost. I knew my innocence was forever gone, something that you cannot get back. So if there are those of you who are still holding on to that gift of virginity, hang on to that. Don't let anyone persuade you otherwise. So that night I went home and kind of moved my food around on the plate, you know. And I went to my room and I called my girlfriend and said, you know, here's what happened. And she said, oh, that's no problem. If you are pregnant, I can take you to a clinic and they can take care of it. So sure enough, I got the pregnancy test done. And the lady said, well, we're going to have some time before we can get the results. So I waited and waited and waited. Come the day I made that phone call to see what the test results were, she said, yes, you are indeed pregnant. And I'm standing in the school on a payphone. Those of you who don't know what that is, it's an old device that goes on a wall. You pick it up, the receiver that's attached to the, and you have to put money in it. So I'm on the phone, the payphone at the school, and said, what? She said, what do you want to do? You're pregnant. And I thought, what do I want to do? I want to go back to sixth grade and play kickball because I know those rules. I know that if I'm home, then I can go to, you know, those rules were clear. I didn't know this new world that I was in. And she said, okay, well now from this moment of conception, you have to wait 6 weeks until we can do an abortion if that's the route you want to go. So why don't you just get back with me? So I went home and I looked and calculated from December 10th, it was my 17th birthday. Was 6 weeks later. So, for my 17th birthday, that's what my boyfriend bought for me, was an abortion. So, after the abortion was over, again, I just went right back to school, slipped into class like nothing had happened, and no one knew what was had just happened. But inside, I was going through what most of the other women have, racked with guilt and shame, suicidal ideations, you know. I started drinking really hard and became bulimic and dealing with PTSD pretty hard. And I'm a graduate from the class of 1984, so we decided that we were going to get drunk 84 weekends in a row. And some of us came very close to that goal, hashtag goals, right? So, but I had all of this going on, and I didn't know how to act. And I got very involved in drama and speech and, you know, threw myself in my school activities. But apparently my mom saw through it. And one day I was in the bathroom and getting ready for school, and she came to me and she said, what's wrong with you? Why are you being such a witch? Only she didn't say witch. And I thought, why is my mother talking to me like this? She had never said anything like that before. And she squares her shoulders with me and she's like, what's wrong with you? Are you on the pill? I thought, okay, that would have been a nice conversation for us to have a long time ago, Mom. And I stood there and thought, no one could know, right? Do I want to tell her what's really going on and why I'm feeling so out of control? And she said, are you on the pill? What's going on? I said, no. I had an abortion. I just let it fall out there on the bathroom floor and see what she was going to do with it. And she just looked at me and she backed up slowly, you know, in the movies where everything's like, whoa. She threw herself back on my waterbed and she just started screaming and crying, no, 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 no. And the more she cried and the more she flailed her arms and legs, the more my waterbed was going crazy. And I'm standing there going, what's she going to do? Is she going to kill her firstborn? Like, I killed mine. I mean, what's she going to do when she gets up off of this? She just cried, no, 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 no. And I just watched. But she did for me what I hope all of you do for these uprisings in the city and for these women who come into your clinics. she wrapped her arms around me. And I don't remember what she said. But that act of, first of all, touching, you know, everything's going to be okay. That's just calming. And if you ever want a hug like that, you can go to 5501 Mesa Del Oso in Farmington, New Mexico, and get one of those from my mom. They're the quality kind that you want to get from everyone. But I had to go back to school and deal with all of these things and kind of come to terms with it. You know, she could offer me nothing that would fix the past. My boyfriend graduated a year before I did, went off to college, and we broke up. And into my senior year, things got even wilder because I'm feeling so out of control and not knowing how to process and become who I'm supposed to be and have these goals and get good grades and have all my life turn right side up again. And one night at a party, one of my trusted friends raped me. I was passed out drunk, and I didn't know what was going on until it was virtually over. And I had to face him every day at school. And so that compounded the PTSD and the drinking and the bulimia and misbehaving. And thankfully, I did not get pregnant at that time. You know, so many people say, but what about rape? What about all these exceptions to abortion? Well, having been raped, even in that case, had I been pregnant, I even told this guy in the midst of what was going on, I will not have another abortion. I will not have another abortion. If you got me pregnant just now, I will not have another abortion. And he kind of flipped out over that. But I'm not one to ever stand for any type of an exception when it comes to abortion. I knew then that I was taking the life of my baby, even at 6 weeks when I had the abortion. But at any point, we know that science tells us life begins at conception. I'm speaking to the choir here on that one. So what do you do when no one could know and I had to act like everything was normal? So, but in spite of behaving that way and having my life in utter chaos and being so suicidal every day, entertaining these ideas, out of 500 students in my graduating class, I was voted class clown. You know, people cover things up and they're trying to be the funny guy. So you can never really know if the funny guy or the funny person at the school is, or wherever your world is, like Robin Williams, the actor who is one of the world's greatest comedians, committed suicide. And when he did, I could instantly connect with his level of funny didn't indicate at all what was going on underneath. You know, we wear these masks and act like everything is fine when it's like the earth and hell. They say many people believe hell is in the center of the earth. You know, Jesus descended into the, anyway, theological discussion there. But we know hell is a real place. And I had forgiven others in my life. I got to the point where I graduated from high school and went off to college in Oklahoma and started listening to my friends who were Christians and decided that, okay, the Christians that I left behind and the Christians that were the reason that I had the abortion weren't necessarily the Christians of everywhere. So I decided not to completely turn my back on God. And in that process, I found Jesus. One day, I was cleaning my bedroom, and I found this bookmarker that I had made when I was 5 or 6 years old. And it references Isaiah 40, verse 8. The grass withers and the flowers fade, but the word of our God stands forever. And at that point in my life, I didn't necessarily know what else the Word of God said, but I knew it said this. And I thought, yeah, the grass is withering and the flowers are fading in my life, but the Word of God is going to stand forever. And that was enough for me to put my feet on solidly and go, okay, I don't know what else is coming. And then I recalled some other scriptures. And I grew hungry for more. Like, what is that that's going to stand forever? I want more of that. So I continued to kind of seek God. And I started listening to Christian radio. And one preacher said one morning, this verse. It says Matthew 11:28, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And it was as if Jesus was standing right in front of me in my bedroom saying, I am right here. Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. I didn't have to work for it. I didn't have to earn it. I didn't have to buy it. I didn't have to go out and get all the stickers and the stars of my attendance on church for X number of days for him to come to me and to offer me to come to him. He was saying, I am right here. Come to me, and I will give you rest. That's deeply profound to me. Because then he brought this next slide to me. He brought this next verse to me. Casting all your cares, all your anxieties, all your worries, all your concerns, once and for all, on him. For he cares about you with deepest affection and watches over you carefully. And what this verse spoke to me was the once and for all in this translation. It meant a lot to me because when I was a little kid, I liked to be what my mom called an Indian giver. Now, we're Indians partially, so don't get offended if, you know, the whole thing. And that's going to offend it. She said, whatever. But I was an Indian giver. But I knew God was telling me, listen, if you're going to cast your cares on me, don't be an Indian giver and take them back and start caring about them again because I'm working on them even as you're asleep. So he cares for you with deepest affection and watches over you carefully. He was inviting me, as I know many of you have sensed him inviting you to draw closer to him. And I wept as I heard all of these things coming out of the radio and the Lord speaking to my heart. And I sensed God's love completely cover me. And there's not hardly a day that's gone by that I don't think about the fact that I have a child in heaven, but the weight of sin is not there anymore. Jesus Christ absolutely set me free that day. Yeah. This God that we serve is real, hey? That's why you all are here today. God is absolutely all about relationship. But maybe you're here today and maybe you too have entertained the idea of suicide, or maybe you have entertained the idea of being bulimic or, you know, throwing your life away and giving up hope. But I hope that coming to this conference and hearing the Word of God and finding camaraderie here, that you are encouraged and that you don't walk out this door with the same baggage, that you are able to lay it all down, cast it all on him once and for all, because he cares for you, hey? And if God Almighty can forgive me of taking the life of my own baby, he can forgive anyone of anything. Suicide is never the answer, hey? And failure is never final. Maybe some of you who've had some failures in your life, but we read the Bible and we look, there's a bunch of failures in there, and that blesses me so much. How about you? You're like, failure, yes, I can do this too. Even the greatest king, King David, yeah? You know his story and his indiscretions. Fell in love with that Bathsheba fox and then sent her husband off to war so he could marry her. Messed up people, I tell you. It's amazing that God can get anything done. We're all he's got to work with. So I'd like to share this video with you. I hope that you take every word of this to heart here.
This one story in particular has had a profound impact on me. It's about a woman who did the impossible, and it made me ask myself if I could do the same. Renee had four kids. Two of her daughters were twins. Megan was coming home from the beach one night with her best friend when their car was struck by a drunk driver named Eric, a 24-year-old kid. Megan lost her life. Eric killed both girls that were in the car. Renee lost her daughter in an instant.
Megan is a very joyful child and had a heart of gold, beautiful, loved people, loved her family, just a joy of my life. And when she was 20 years old, on May 11th, 2002, my sister-in-law came to the door to tell me that Megan had been in a car accident and she didn't make it. You know, my heart was so broken, and I looked at her and said, "No, you're kidding," and, you know, still looking for her to tell me that this is not really true, that Megan wasn't coming back home.
Next thing she knows, she finds herself in a courtroom watching this young man, this 24-year-old man, get sentenced to 22 years in prison. After Renee lost her daughter, she said she found herself in the darkest place she'd ever been. This guy Eric was behind bars, but she said she felt like the prisoner. Why? Because she had all this bitterness and hatred built up towards that young man. And so she reached out and did the impossible. She reached out to Eric in prison and said, "I forgive you." The ripple effects of that act of forgiveness are still being felt today. That young man's life was absolutely changed because this woman forgave him. He said, "I can't even forgive myself," and she forgave me. One by one, all of Renee's family members followed her lead, and they reached out and expressed forgiveness to Eric. So much so that now they describe Eric as part of their family, like a son to Renee. The story doesn't stop there, though. Renee went to the courts along with her family, and she was able to have Eric's sentence cut in half from 22 years to 11 years.
He told me that day, the day of the hearing, that it didn't matter at this point. He said, "You know, if the judge does not grant this for me, I want you to know that I am so grateful that you are willing to do this." And he said, "And I will be okay." He said, I'll be fine. But I'm just, he was blown away by the fact that we were willing to go before the judge and you know, plead for him to not have to be there for 22 years.
Give away the last thing on your mind today, and it always goes to those who don't deserve. It's the opposite of how you feel when the pain they cause is just too real. Takes everything you have to say the word forgiveness.
I was more than angry at Eric. I had so much rage inside of me, and yet the moment that I was able to look Eric in his eyes and tell him that I forgive him, you know, that was a moment that healing began for both of us.
It's always anger's own worst enemy. And even when the jury and the judge say you got a right to hold a grudge, it's the whisper in your ear saying set it free. Forgiveness.
A judge and a jury telling you that it's okay to hold a grudge. You know, that's what the world says. It's okay for you to feel that way, which it is. But yet, those feelings, they're inside of you, eating away at you, and you don't want to live your life that way.
Forgiveness. Show me how to love the unlovable. Show me how to reach the unreachable.
There are people who are not going to ever have someone say to them, "I'm sorry for what I did," or "I take responsibility for what I did," and you still have to forgive if you want to heal.
It can even set a prisoner free. There is no end to what its power can do. So let it go and be amazed by what you see through eyes of grace. The prisoner that it really frees is you. Forgiveness.
you're not letting go of what happened. You know, it is wrong. It should never have happened. It is not okay. It doesn't mean that you're canceling any of that out. But once you are able to say those words and truly mean it, you know, then you do find that you're setting a prisoner free, and the prisoner truly is you.
I was immediately inspired by Renee's story when I read it, but it took me a while to write her song. I kept her story in my guitar case for about 2 years, and I realized the reason why it was so difficult to write this song, Forgiveness, is because it's kind of hard to live that out. That's why the words of the chorus are sung in the form of a prayer. God, show me how. Help me to do the impossible. This story of forgiveness really makes me think that there's some pretty life-defining questions that all revolve around that one word, forgiveness. Questions like, is there somebody that I need to forgive, that I've been holding on to a grudge and it's weighing me down? Every step's getting heavier and I just need to set it free. Another question is there someone that I need to go and ask for forgiveness from? To say, I'm humbling myself, I'm sorry, no excuses, can we start over? Another forgiveness question, one that Eric has had to deal with in prison, is, can I ever forgive myself? What if loving the unlovable means having to learn how to love that person you see when you look in the mirror? Sometimes that's not an easy task, which really leads to the most significant forgiveness question of all, and it's this. Have I ever let it really sink in? The message of God's forgiveness, what He's done for me through His Son Jesus dying on a cross for my sins. Renee stood before that judge, along with all of her family members, taking turns speaking on behalf of a guilty criminal and seeking mercy for him. I'm reminded that somebody has done that for me, somebody has done that for you, and His name is Jesus. For God demonstrates His own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Why did He do that? So that our stories could discover the healing, the victory, the redemption, the power, the freedom of one word, forgiveness.
It's the opposite of how you feel. When the pain they caused, it's just too real, right? And I think even in the religious circles, there are a lot of us who are guilty of not forgiving ourselves. You know, how many times have we prayed the Our Father prayer, where we pray, forgive those who have trespassed against us? You know how it goes, right? But we don't forgive ourselves because we don't feel worthy. But we don't have to feel worthy in order to be forgiven, because Jesus has come so that we might have life and have it more abundantly. So maybe your world has been turned upside down, and maybe you need your world turned upside down. But whatever your situation is today, we are here in unity to do just that. Maybe you've even been one who've set your city in an uproar. But whatever unforgiveness you might be holding on to today, I just encourage you to not be an Indian giver and throw it over onto the Lord. I love that verse says, cast your cares on the Lord. You know, as a girl who grew up fishing with her daddy all the time, I loved casting But the problem is we keep reeling it back in. Cast it out there, reeling it back in. And as a kid, that's what I like to do. I didn't care if I caught anything. I just like casting and reeling and casting and reeling. But that's how we pray, right? Sometimes we pray, we cast our prayer out there, and we reel it back in so that we can worry about it. God, that's okay. I'm going to take it from here. I've prayed about it, but now I'm going to worry about it a little bit. And I'm going to talk to my cousins, and I'm going to talk to my mom, and I'm going to call my pastor, and I'm going to call my minister. I'm going to call these other people as if God's going, I thought you cast your cares on me. Do you trust me? I mean, I sense the Lord saying that to me a lot. Do you trust me with that? You know, you've prayed about that thing. Now take your hands off and watch me go to work. Yeah. And that can be a heavy thing, especially when it deals with unforgiveness, especially sometimes when it is our own mess. But God basically, here's 1 Kristan 5:7 in the Bible says, I love you so much that even if you make a mess in your britches and fall down in it, I'm going to love you stink and all. Yeah. That's our God. He loves us stink and all. There is another king. His name is Jesus. You know John 3:16, right? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. But one day I kept reading and I found John 3:17. Have you guys read it? It's amazing. For God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Jesus didn't come to condemn me. That was a big news flash. He didn't come to condemn the world, but to set it free. So will you pray with me? Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. You know, this God that we serve is just an amazing, amazing God. And I hope that you guys can take this message today and just go light up your world and wherever you're returning home to turn it right side up again. And that you're quick to forgive and you're quick to repent and you're quick to cast your cares on the Lord and walk free. Amen. Thank you so much. I appreciate you coming. Thank you.